So we are looking at linear functionals leading to the notion of the adjoint of an operator. Okay, so let me recall this result that we proved last time. Let V be a finite dimensional in a product space. And F be a linear functional on V. Then there exists a unique vector y in V such that f of x is nothing but the inner product of x with this fixed vector y for every x in V. This y will of course depend on f, because we have seen the formula for y. Okay, the formula for y is summation j equals 1 to n f of uj bar uj. So it depends on f, and this uj comes from a basis. Is an orthonormal basis. Of V. Okay, using this, we'll now look at the notion of the adjoint of an operator. So let's first prove this result. Let V be a finite dimensional inner product space. And T be a linear operator. T is a linear transformation on a finite dimensional inner product space. Then there exists a linear operator T star on V. So we will call this operator T star. There exists a linear operator T star on V such that the following holds. Remember, we are calling it T star, so it does depend on T, and it in particular satisfies the following property. It's linear, of course. It satisfies the following property such that if you look at the inner product of Tx with Y, this is the inner product of X with T star Y. This must be true for all x, y in V. So what this result claims is that there is on a finite dimensional inner product space V, there is this operator. This is unique. So let me mention that also. There exists a unique linear operator, which we'll call T star. This T star will call it as the adjoint of the operator T. Okay, that we will do a little later. First, to prove this, we will appeal to the previous theorem. So in order to apply the previous theorem, we need to look at a functional. So the proof is as follows. Let y belong to V be fixed. I will tell you what T star y is. Okay, then I need to see that it's unique. T star y is unique, and then the T star satisfies this, and finally T star is linear. Okay. Define the following operator. Define phi y. It depends on y. Phi y from V to R or C within brackets R. Define this operator by phi y of x. Equals, I will now invoke the operator T. Use the operator T in the definition of this functional phi y. y is fixed, this x varies. So this is an inner product. Okay, phi y of x is a number, real or a complex number. Now t appears here, so you can show that phi is linear, phi y is linear. Then phi y is linear, phi y of alpha x plus beta z, you can show that it is equal to alpha phi y of x plus beta phi y of z. So phi y is linear, it is a linear functional. I appeal to the previous theorem. By the previous theorem, there exists a unique, I will call it z. By the previous result, there exists a unique z in V such that the action of phi y on any vector x is the inner product of the vector x with z. What is important is to realize again that it is unique. This uniqueness will imply the uniqueness of this operator t star, in fact. Okay, so we started with y, we started with y in V. We have got a unique vector z that satisfies this equation for all x. So we will associate this z to y under t star. So the definition is set t star y equals z. Now you can do this for every, you can do this for every fixed y, that is given a y. I will define this linear functional and then I know how to get this unique z. Then for that while I'll associate this z. So this is, since this right hand side is unique for this y, this is well defined in the first place. We need to verify it is linear, but before that let us verify that this t star satisfies this equation, that is straightforward. Also if you look at tx comma y, I will start with x with t star y. X with t star y is, by definition, t star y is z. So that is x with z, but x with z is here, that is phi y of x, and phi y of x by definition is t x y. This is true first for all x in V. And then I vary y, then this is true for all y in V. Okay. First I fix y and then this is true for all x, then I vary y, appealing to that z which comes for this particular y. So this equation holds, x comma t star y is equal to t x comma y for all x and y. We need to show t star is linear. So that is also not difficult. So we need to show t star is linear. So let us consider, I have used the variables x, y and z. Okay, let me use x will remain a variable. I want to show t star is linear. Let us say t star alpha y plus w. Now I know that t star satisfies this equation. I will make use of that. So I must so let us look at this. I will show that this is equal to inner product x with alpha t star y plus t star w. This is true for all x, so t star is linear. So consider this. By definition, t star satisfies this condition that x with t star y must be tx with y. So this is equal to inner product tx with alpha y plus w. That can be written as tx comma alpha y plus tx comma w. Now here I will take alpha bar outside, I will do two steps. I will take alpha bar outside and then tx comma y is what I will get, that I will write as x comma t star y. The next term is x comma t star w. Now I will take this alpha bar inside, so this gives me x comma alpha t star y plus x comma t star w. This x can be taken common, x alpha t star y plus t star w. This is true for all x. Okay. And so I started with x with t star of something. I show that it is x of alpha t star of y plus t star w. This is true for all x, so it means that t star of alpha x plus w, sorry, alpha y plus w. I have shown that this is equal to alpha t star y plus t star w. C or R. Again, we have made use of the fact that if inner product of x with z equal to 0 for all x, then z must be 0. xz plus yz. Which term? What, where is your doubt? This one? It is an inner product, no? So, inner product of x comma y plus w is inner product of x comma y plus inner product of x comma w. You can use that whenever there is no scalar. Okay. Your question is what happens, why is this true? Okay. Start with the left hand side. Left hand side is y plus w x conjugate. Now it is you know that it is linear with respect to the first one, y x plus w x conjugate, then y x conjugate plus y x conjugate plus w x conjugate, that is x y plus x w. If I have not mentioned it, please take this as the explanation. See, the inner product is linear with respect to the first variable, and with respect to the second variable it is additive. It is conjugate linear with respect to the second variable, but it is additive with respect to the second variable. That is something we are we have been using probably without mentioning. Okay, so for we have shown that this t star is of course well defined and it is linear. Why is it unique? Unique because z is unique. That is, if there is, okay, I leave that part to you. If there is some other operator s that satisfies the equation inner product tx with y is equal to x comma sy, if there is some other operator s such that inner product tx y equals x comma sy for all x and y, then s is equal to t star. Okay, you can show that s is equal to t star. So t star is unique, so I will just mention that. You fill up the last line. Also, t star is unique. I have told you how to prove it, but in any case that is not difficult. So t star is unique. So let us go to the definition of the adjoint using this result. Let V be an inner product space and T be linear. If there exists an operator, a linear operator, T star on V such that inner product tx with y equals x comma t star y. If this is satisfied for all x, y and v, then t star is called, if there exists again a unique linear operator, then t star is called the adjoint of the operator T. The adjoint operator. So what we have proved now is that if V is finite dimensional, then any linear operator has the adjoint. Okay. So remember that this T star is defined by means of this equation. So it depends on the inner product. T star, of course, depends on T. It will also depend on the inner product because it must satisfy this equation. Okay. Okay. We look at some examples of adjoint operators, how to compute the adjoint. Infinite case, the adjoint may not exist. You can look at, I will just give a loose answer. You can look at the differentiation operator. Differentiation operator on the space of continuous functions. You can show that this does not have the adjoint. If time permits, I will discuss this also. If it is infinite dimensional, adjoint may not exist for a linear operator. Okay. You will discuss this in your functional analysis course. Infinite dimensions will be discussed in a functional analysis course. Okay. Look at some examples, but before that, let us settle one or two easy questions that would arise naturally. For instance, given a inner product space, given a finite dimensional inner product space along with an ordered orthonormal basis, I write down the matrix of T relative to that ordered orthonormal basis. What will be the ordered, what will be the matrix representation of T star? What do we expect the answer to be? It can't be the same. It can't be the same unless T is self adjoint. Okay, but before that, let's address this question. Okay, recall that when we looked at the notion of why an orthonormal basis is better than an ordinary basis. In the representation of vectors, that is, if you look at the representation of a vector with respect to a basis, x equal to, let us say the basis is u1, u2, etc., un, just an ordinary basis, then x is alpha 1, u1, etc., alpha n, un, where alpha 1, etc., alpha n, one needs to compute by solving a system of equations. Whereas, if u1, u2, etc., un, where an orthonormal basis, you do not have to compute these numbers, they are just inner products of x with u1, x with u2, etc. So computation of the coefficients, that becomes easier. Similarly, remember the matrix representation of a linear transformation that we have discussed. So let me discuss, recall this and then go to the inner product space. How is the matrix of a linear operator relative to a basis written? So this is also something we can quickly recall. I will use u1, u2, etc. for the orthonormal basis. Let us take b to be say w1, w2, etc., wn. This is an ordinary basis. This is an ordered basis. For a vector space V, okay, there is no inner product space now. For a vector space V, T is also linear. That is given. T is linear, then how do we write down the matrix of T relative to this basis B? We looked at a more general notion of how we write down the matrix of T relative to two bases. If the vector space, see, we discuss V to W. If W equals V, then it is convenient to deal with just one basis. That is this. So what is this? This is the matrix of T relative to B. I will call that A. That is given by the image of the first vector, I am calling it W1. write down TW1. This is a vector in V that can be written in terms of B. Collect the coefficients, that's the first column, that is this, etc. TWJ, this is the jth column. TWN, this is the nth column. This is how you write down the matrix of A relative to this basis. Okay. This means what is the formula then connecting the entries of A and the right hand side images? T of WJ, for instance, do you remember that formula? What is the formula? All you have to do is just look at the left hand side, take the jth column. The jth column of A, what are those entries? Jth column means the second entry varies, is that, sorry, the first entry varies. Is it okay? Tell me if this is clear. The formula for Aij is what I want. This is I want the formula for TUJ, TWJ. I want the formula for TWJ. So what is that? In terms of the matrix, in terms of the entries of A. Do you remember this? J, summation I equals 1 to n, Aij Wi. Is that okay? That's because if you write TWJ is the jth column, does this give the jth column? The first entry is what varies, so this gives the jth column. Okay. Okay, this is the formula for the matrix of a linear transformation relative to a basis. And how do you compute these Aijs again? Aijs are computed, it is a jth column, so you go to the jth column. That is, you look at WJ, image of T under WJ, image of WJ under T relative to this basis, you write a representation. That's amounting to solving a system of equations. Okay, so in general, if you have an ordinary ordered basis, these coefficients are obtained by solving equations. But if it's an orthonormal basis, then you would expect the computation to be easier. So let's first prove that. Let V be a finite dimensional inner product space. I expected at least one of you to answer this. Let V be a finite dimensional inner product space and B equals U1, U2, etc., UN, B an orthonormal basis. Of V. Let T be a linear operator. Okay, you remember this notation. L of V is a set of all linear transformations from V into V. Let T be a linear operator. And A be the matrix of T relative to this orthonormal basis P. Then, can you make a guess? That's not correct, but let me ask you the question. What is the formula for Aij? What is the formula for Aij? Yes, it's an inner product. Yes, inner product of what with what? No, now the basis is orthonormal basis U1, etc., U1, ordered orthonormal basis. It's an ordered orthonormal basis. I have not written, but this is an ordered orthonormal basis. I want the formula for Aij. What is the formula for if I write x as a linear combination of an orthonormal base in terms of an orthonormal basis? Okay, what is it? So what is the inner product here? There is no x. It's the other way around. T u j with u i. And this is the formula. Okay, which means what? You simply take one inner product. Look at the image of u j under t. Take the inner product of that with u i. Then it's that gives the entry a i j. This is the formula for a i j. As before, the entries, the coefficients or the so-called coordinates of a vector x relative to an orthonormal basis are obtained by simply taking the inner product of that vector with each of those orthonormal basis vectors. You get this, okay. This is analogous to that result. Now to prove this, just use this formula. Proof, I want to look at Tuj. Tuj, so I will use this formula. Instead of wj, wi, it will be uj, ui. So Tuj is summation, okay, I am using I here, so I will use a k here. K equal to, I am just rewriting this formula. I am rewriting this formula relative to this basis. Summation k equal to 1 to n akj uk. Akj uk, okay, that is this formula. This is Tuj. All I have to do is look at inner product Tuj with ui. Tuj with ui, let us not do all these, just k equals 1 to n akj, that comes out inner product. This is the first term, so this is uk ui. K is a running index, k is the summation index. When, see, this I is fixed. When I write this formula, this I is fixed for me. So when k is a running index, when k takes a value I, this is 1, all other entries are 0 because it's an orthonormal basis. When k takes a value I, it is aij, all other terms are 0, which is what we wanted to prove. Tuj ui is aij. So this is a formula connecting, this is a formula for computing the entries of the matrix A. It is obtained by these n square inner products. Okay, remember this formula connecting, okay, again this problem, go back to the vector space case, not the inner product space. Vector space case, we defined the so-called transpose of a linear transformation. The transpose was shown to be unique. So the question is, if A is the matrix of a linear operator T relative to a basis B, what is a matrix of T transpose as a linear transformation? We have seen that it is a transpose of the matrix of T, okay. An entirely similar result holds for the adjoint operator. Now that is very easy. So you can think of the star as a kind of a generalization of the transpose operation. So I will state that as okay, a lemma or a theorem. I will be cryptic. I will follow what the notation that we have used before. I will simply say that my matrix A is the matrix of the transformation T relative to B. Then the matrix of T star, okay, let I will call B as the matrix of T star relative to the orthonormal basis B. Then the conclusion is B star equals A. Remember, the star of a linear transformation on inner product space has been defined just today. Okay, but what I am writing down here is the complex conjugate of matrices. See, this A and B are matrices, that we know. The complex conjugate of a matrix, we know. You interchange rows and columns, after taking the conjugate transpose, after taking the conjugate, right? This matrix A has complex entries. Take the complex conjugates of that, of the entries of A, then take the transpose, you get A star. So this is how B star is constructed. So the matrices of T and T star relative to this particular basis, relative to any basis that you start with, provided you stick to that basis for T star, they are related by this formula. So proof, again you have to simply use the formula for the entries of B star and A. Okay, so okay, let's use the previous one. Let me write down Bij. What is the formula for Bij? Bij, B is defined through this. Bij by definition must be T star Uj Ui. Is that okay? T star Uj Ui. But this is Uj T Ui because that's how the adjoint is defined. But this is T Ui comma Uj, the conjugate of that. But T Ui comma Uj, go back to the previous result, is Aij. Aij bar. Aji bar. Yes, this first and then this. Aji bar, that's what we wanted to prove. That is B equals A star. Now complex conjugation, we know, you do it once more, you get the same matrix. See, this formula is correct, right? Mm-hmm. Bij.
Next step.
How is the adjoint defined?
You know, is T star T?
We are not using that. See, T star is T is correct, but we are not using that. I have not proved it, so I am not using it.
But we only have Tx in a product of Tx, is Tx and Y is in a product of X and T star.
The same thing can be used, like what the argument that I gave for the second argument, that can be given here. No, but where have I used that? I don't understand. See, T star Uj Ui, this T star, okay, see, you can take the conjugate and then go back to this. You want that explanation? Okay, let's you have objection then. What you want is an explanation for this, right? So I can write this as Ui T star Uj conjugate. Okay, then it is a conjugate of Tui comma Uj, but that is the same as Uj comma Tui. Sorry, the proof of ends here, right? Tui Uj. Tui Uj will be Aji going along with the bar. So, agreed? Is that okay? Bij, Ij, that's T star. And then it is Ui with T star Uj conjugate, keep the conjugate. Then I use the adjoint operation, Tui Uj, but Tui Uj is Aji that goes along with the bar. So, probably a more direct proof if you want. And so, as I mentioned before, B star equals A. I have shown that B is equal to A star, but the star operation is of period 2. Okay. You do it once more, you get the same matrix. Any problem again? This proves B equal to A star, but you do the star once again, because it's a matrix now, then I get this. So I still don't prove that for a linear transformation T, T star is T. I'm not using that. I'm using it for a matrix. I'm using what it tells me for matrices. For matrices, you can verify that by just writing down the entries, right? Okay. So let's look at some examples. Both. can't expect this to happen. It's only with respect to the same basis that the relationship holds. In fact, if you look at just an ordinary basis, which is not an orthonormal basis, then this relationship does not hold. If it's not an orthonormal basis, just an ordinary basis, then this relationship is not true. It's a more complicated formula. How A and B are related, if it's just an ordinary basis, will not be the same as this. That relationship is different. It's more complicated. But what's more meaningful and what is more applicable is writing it related to the same basis. Okay, I want to discuss examples. Let me take two, one finite dimension, the other one infinite dimension. Examples of transposes. How do you compute the transpose of certain operators? Let's take V as C n cross n with the trace in the product. Let us say if I have AB in V, then this is trace of B star A. With respect to the trace inner product, this was given as one of the examples of an inner product space. Define the operator LM. Define the operator LM from V to V for a fixed M in V by this formula. LM of A is M times A. This is a left multiplication, that is why this L is given. Left multiplication by M. A is the variable. M is fixed, A is a variable. Left multiplication by M. What is the adjoint of this operator? What is the adjoint of this operator? Okay, let's calculate. By the way, this is linear. That's an easy exercise. LM is linear, that's left to you. I want to calculate the adjoint. To calculate the adjoint, I must appeal to the formula, the first principle definition. I want to look at LM A comma B. I want to write it as, say I want to compute T star, so I must write TX comma Y as X comma T star Y. So I must write this as A comma something of B, that something will give me the T star. LM star. So this is what? This is by LMA, I'll apply the definition. It's MAB. That's trace of B star, the second one. So this is trace of B star MA. Multiplication is matrix multiplication associated to, by I still insist that I write this bracket. Appeal to this fact, the trace of the product, that is trace of, let us say C times D is trace of D times C. I will keep applying that trace of till I am satisfied. Trace of MA B star. Okay, trace of MA B star, that is the same as trace of M times AB star, right? B star MA is trace MA B star. I will write this as trace MA B star. So I want to take A outside, okay. No, I will not write like this. I want to keep A to the left. I will write this as again the same thing, AB star M, which is a trace of A m star b whole star. This is a into b star m. B star m is this whole star. Again, I am dealing with this reverse order law for matrices, not for transformations, which I have not yet proved. So I get this, but this is the same as, now I have taken A outside and star of something. So remember that the formula for the inner product then is given by A m star B, okay. Do you agree? This can be written as A comma m star B is L m star of B, left multiplication of m star with B, L m star of B. And so what does it mean? If you look at L m star, that is L m star, this is true for all A B. So the conjugate of L m is L of the conjugate. With respect to m star, m is what I started with. Left multiplication, the conjugate is left multiplication with the conjugate of that matrix, okay. This is for the finite dimensional case. Let us look at an infinite dimensional example. Let us consider the space of all polynomials with complex entries, complex coefficients. Space of all polynomials with complex coefficients, the inner product is the usual inner product, integral 0 to 1, f of t g bar, f g bar. Now what is g t bar? G is a complex polynomial, the variable is real, coefficients are complex. The variable is real, coefficients are complex. So g t bar, if g equal to, let us say, a1 a0 plus a1 t etc an t to the n, where a0 a1 etc are complex numbers, g t bar will be a0 bar plus a1 bar t plus a2 bar t square etc plus an bar t to the n, okay. So I take the complex conjugate of the coefficients, that is my definition. So with that definition, I give this inner product, this is an inner product. So V with this you can show is an inner product space. I will look at the following operator. Again, something similar to the previous one, left multiplication by a fixed polynomial. Define let us say L or T, T from V to V by T of G is F with G for a fixed F element of V. So I can actually call it T F of G. Take a fixed F in G, fixed F in V, take a fixed polynomial, simply multiply, given any G, simply multiply, on the left, on the right does not matter, polynomial multiplication is commutative, unlike the previous one. What is TF? This is TF. What is T star F? That is the question. So what do you expect the answer to be? What is F star for a function? For a matrix M, M star is known. What is F star for a function? It should be F bar. We can show that TF, T star is TF bar. Okay. Okay, let us do that quickly. Again, first principle, use the first principle definition. I want the inner product of TF G comma H. I want to calculate this. I must write it as G comma something, and then that something will give me T star. So this is by definition, TFGH by definition, TFG is FG, FGH. For FGH, the definition is integral 0 to 1, F of T, G of T, H T bar. I must kind of take out g, but it's clear how we should do that. 0 to 1, see this is matrix, I'm sorry, this is polynomial multiplication, so it's commutative. I can take gt outside and then combine the other two and put them under a bar. I want f to be without bar, so ft bar h must go with this. So do I get what I want? Double bar gives me f, single bar gives me h bar. I can call this l of t bar if you want, and then write this. This is integral 0 to 1 g of t l of t bar dt, but that is by definition inner product of g with l, which is g with l is f bar h, which is I observe g t f bar of h. So what I have proved is that t f g with h is g comma t f bar h for all f g, for all f g h, for all g h, I am sorry, f is fixed, g h are the variable polynomials. So this means t f star is t f bar. Okay, so this example tells you that star behaves like conjugation. Adjoint behaves like complex conjugate. That's what I mean. The adjoint operation star behaves like complex conjugate, taking the bar. It also behaves like complex conjugate. See, when I say complex conjugate, it is z is a complex number, z bar is what I am calling complex conjugate, maybe just conjugate. The previous example also has the conjugate, lm star is m star. M star already has conjugate, okay. So star, the adjoint operation kind of behaves like the conjugation that you do for a complex number, okay. We will explore this a little further and see how some of the properties of the adjoint are similar to the properties of the complex conjugate, okay. So let me stop here.